On the East Coast, it's been hot, 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 hot. Records broken day after day. And tonight, the hot air will go out again as the Republican presidential race starts up with a face-off in primetime debate in Manchester, New Hampshire.
Well, Pat, you know, David Brody is a phenomenal reporter, and he comes with us today with a story about voters in this early primary state who appear to be in a Tea Party frame of mind.
This is not your typical New Hampshire indoor picnic lunch. This one is filled with elephants. It's the Hillsborough County Republican Picnic, considered one of the biggest 2012 campaign kickoff events. But hot dogs and hamburgers are not the only item on the menu. So are the topics of the budget and high unemployment, the top two concerns of New Hampshire voters. So it's no coincidence that you see Tea Party souvenirs and hear a familiar agenda.
I think New Hampshire is the Tea Party voters. Principles that you're now seeing as Tea Party across the country have always been New Hampshire principles.
New Hampshire is a state that had been a very conservative state for a long time, and it's not as much now that it as it used to be, but it's definitely we're leading that way again, and we want to see some major changes.
We're in trouble. We don't want no candy coating. We want to hear that we're in trouble because that will rally people, and I want to hear solutions of what they're going to do.
Some GOP candidates like Tim Pawlenty and Herman Cain came to offer voters want to hear.
I have run stuff, fixed stuff, turned stuff around, started stuff, and solved stuff. I have a long record of stuff, and I want to take it to the White House.
Whether it's Republican picnic events like this, or for that matter, any event in New Hampshire, you're going to see all of the GOP candidates show up. That is not the case in Iowa, the state that votes before New Hampshire. There are a few candidates that are just not competing in Iowa, like Mitt Romney and soon-to-be presidential candidate John Huntsman. That state's a little too conservative for a couple of those candidates, but here in New Hampshire, it's a free-for-all. Mitt Romney is banking on a win here to propel him to victory, much like a 2008 win did for John McCain. His opposition knows that they need a stop here, or Romney could run away with the nomination. Candidates like Tim Pawlenty are up here hitting the tavern circuit to appeal to Republican voters hit hard by the economy.
Barack Obama and his administration last summer said it was going to be the summer of recovery. Remember that? Recovery summer. How was your recovery summer? Yeah? You didn't need to get too much SPF out for that, did you?
This early debate is important because polls up here show that nearly three-quarters of voters haven't made up their mind yet.
I'm one of those. I have not jumped on anybody's campaign right now. I'm in education mode.
And folks in this key state know they play a big role at the polls.
In New Hampshire, politics, you know, this is Friday night football for us. This is our state sport.
And the GOP crowd takes the field tonight with the goal of making a good first impression on the debate stage. David Brody, CBN News in Manchester, New Hampshire.
There was a time that New Hampshire mirrored America, and so if somebody won in New Hampshire, he pretty much would be certain of winning the country. That was a place where Ronald Reagan said, I paid for that microphone, and he won essentially the Republican nomination on his strong showing. They had beautiful posters of Reagan with a cowboy hat and said, this is Reagan country. I mean, it was, and he wore, you know, the typical Western garb to look like he was one of the mountaineers. But New Hampshire's different. The people have come over from Massachusetts. It's much more liberal down in the southern part of the state. It doesn't reflect America anymore at all. And normally speaking, whoever's governor of Massachusetts is the guy who can win New Hampshire because he can send an army of people across the border. And it only takes about 35, 40,000 people to win that primary. So they maybe it's 70 or 80 now, but it isn't a big deal. Everybody makes it out to be.
That's true. You know, as you're sitting here talking, I was thinking about the story that we just saw and how more and more people are, they don't have an alliance anymore to a particular party. More and more people are becoming not necessarily independent, but trying to see which one is going to kind of go in their direction. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, well, in New Hampshire, though, I mean, you've got to, they say, well, I've got to shake the hand of the candidate about four or five times before I make up my mind. I mean, it's nonsense. You don't get that privilege anyplace else in the world. But it's all these coffees and these little clutches and these little town hall meetings. And I had a campaign manager who wanted me to shake, I think, 1,500 or 1,400 hands every day.
Oh, my Lord.
Oh, I was in factories and shopping malls. And I mean, I tell you, I wish in hindsight I had bypassed the state. It was not a good experience at all. But nevertheless, they're off and running, and we'll see what happens. Because the Tea Party may have changed the equation in New Hampshire. It made me go back to being conservative as it used to be. Well, you can keep up with the latest from David Brody on the presidential race by checking out the Brody file on CBNNews.com. And Lee, New Hampshire, brother, Florida, whatever.
Yeah, it's quite a state. And speaking of those economic issues, Pat, that Tim Pawlenty and others were talking about, many Americans may not be able to retire until they're in their 70s or even 80s. That's according to a recent study from the Employee Benefit Research Institute. Lower income Americans will have to work the longest just to afford basic necessities after they retire. The earlier you start saving, of course, the better. And the longer people work past 65 and the longer they keep contributing to their retirement plans, the better off they'll be after they stop working. Falling real estate prices are still eating away at the equity in American homes. It's near its lowest point since World War II. Average homeowners own just 38% of their homes now, compared to 61% a decade ago. Home equity usually goes up as people pay off their mortgages, but falling home prices mean Americans are losing value in their homes, even as they reduce their mortgage debt, Pat.
Just think, this goes all the way back to World War II. Let's say 1945, 55, 65, 75, 85, 95, 200. That's a long time. And during all that period of time, house values went up. And so it was considered the safest investment, and everybody thought, well, I can invest in my home, and then I can draw money out. It's like an ATM machine. I can pull out money for a second mortgage and whatever. And suddenly, that dream is shattered, and the wealth of a vast number of Americans is no longer there. And it's having a huge impact. It'll have a more impact on, they won't be able to shop as much. They won't be able to buy securities. They won't be able to take vacations. They won't be able to do a lot of things because they don't have the money. And it was tied up in real estate, which has taken another hit. So it's kind of sad, but it'll be one more nail, if you will, in this economic coffin that is being built in Washington. Lee?
Pat, Turkey's Islamist-based AKP party kept its power in this weekend's elections. Many analysts, though, are concerned it will lead to a more radical form of Islam in that country. Chris Mitchell has the story now from Istanbul.
This is the one some consider the new strongman in the Middle East, the most powerful leader in the Muslim world, and a politician the U.S. and Israel will have to contend with for at least the next 4 years. His AKP party won 50% of the vote and 325 seats in Turkey's parliament. It gives the AKP a big majority, but not enough seats to independently rewrite Turkey's constitution, their main goal. Many feared if they won enough seats in parliament, they'd rewrite Turkey's constitution and institute Sharia law. But the results do accelerate Turkey's growing influence in the region.
With Turkey literally straddling Europe and Asia, the Turks see themselves as a nation of bridges. The government is also building political bridges within the Muslim world, positioning itself to fill a power void left by declining U.S. influence in the Middle East.
That's why Erdogan said after Sunday's victory, "Believe me, Sarajevo won today as much as Istanbul. Beirut won as much as Izmir. Damascus won as much as Ankara. Ramallah, Nablus, Jenin, the West Bank, Jerusalem, won as much as Diyarbakir." The government insists its agenda is to implement a Western-style democracy. But some see a number of warning signs behind that claim. More journalists are in jail in Turkey than most any other nation, and the government plans to restrict internet use in August. Another concern,
The AKP and Erdogan are closely linked to the Fethullah Gulen movement, whose agenda is to achieve world domination through Islam. And Middle East expert Daniel Pipes warned Sunday's election might be the last fair and free ones in Turkey. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Istanbul.
Pat, what are your concerns about this?
Well, very much, Lee. You remember, you go back and the Turks were the Ottoman Empire, and that, of course, was an Islamic organization that was reaching, trying to take domination, not only in the Middle East, but domination over Europe. And they came right to the gates of Vienna a long time ago, and then they finally were overcome. But the Ottomans dominated the Middle East. They dominated Jerusalem. They dominated the holy sites. And they took over Constantinople and turned the Hagia Sophia church into a mosque. I mean, it was a bad thing. Now, what's happening next? Ataturk in the 20s came in and he said, we're going to have a secular country. We're not going to have a religious country. And so suddenly there's a fresh wave of freedom, and the Turks became strong allies. They were called the sick man of Europe, but nevertheless, they were opening up. And suddenly, what is written in prophecy is starting to take place. Read the 38th chapter of the book of the prophet Ezekiel. And when you see a coalition coming against Israel in the latter days, it includes something. I think the term is Gomer. Gomer's not Germany. It's more likely Turkey. And Turkey would be in the coalition against Israel. And you hear what the victor of this election was saying. My victory has something to do with Yugoslavia. It has something to do with Damascus. It has something to do with the Holy Land. But they're not thinking small, and they're thinking Sharia, and they're thinking restore the caliphate and all that stuff that goes on. It's happening before our eyes. So am I concerned about it? Absolutely. Lee?
Yesterday was Pentecost Sunday. Millions of Christians in more than 200 nations came together to cry out to God on the global day of prayer. For the first time in its 11-year history, a U.S. city hosted the main event. Ephraim Graham has that story.
Veterans Memorial Arena in Jacksonville, Florida, hosted the world's largest prayer gathering. The kickoff event, held on the eve of the global day of prayer, united Christians around the globe by satellite.
Let us right now put our voices together and our hands together and welcome the rest of the world to Jacksonville, Florida.
Global Day of Prayer founder Graham Power set the tone, putting the focus on God.
So this is not about big names. It's not about artists. This is about humbling ourselves and praying.
Then Jacksonville's pastors took to the stage to lead the world in prayer.
Together with believers all over the world, we gather today to glorify your name. You are the creator of heaven and earth. There is no one like you, holy and righteous in all your ways.
They prayed in many languages. Similar scenes took place across the world on Pentecost Sunday. In this town square in Mexico City, Christians prayed to the Lord to stop the violence, kidnappings, and drug trade that is destroying their country. They prayed for 24 hours straight. The Philippines held the first ever Kids Global Day of Prayer, building up young people to carry the mantle of prayer into the future.
I've learned that today we must pray for other people.
Lord, please take care of the poor people. Please give them homes. Please give them enough food that they can eat.
In Romania, they prayed all day long, asking God for renewal in the church, reform in government and media, and victory over societal evils like abortion and human trafficking. In London, rainy weather forced the celebrations inside. Nevertheless, Christians in 33 boroughs across the city took part. Back in Jacksonville, the Global Day of Prayer passed the baton to church leaders in Jakarta, Indonesia, next year's host city, and wrapped up by proclaiming once more,
the Spirit and the Bride says, say it with me, amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
Ephraim Gray, CBN News.
Pat, I'm proud of Jacksonville for hosting that. I had the privilege of living and working there for 10 years, and a lot of great Christian folks down there.
They really are. That's a beautiful thing, and to think all around the world, people praying. God will hear those prayers.
New Zealand is rocked by its second earthquake in 4 months. It caused two buildings to collapse in the already quake-damaged city of Christchurch. The U.S. Geological Survey recorded one aftershock today at 5.2. The largest one came at lunchtime and forced people to flee from buildings in panic. Back in February, a quake killed 181 people in Christchurch, New Zealand, and brought down the historic St. John's Church. Police say two people were trapped in that church today after the tremor, but they were rescued. Children in Cambodia are getting involved with the CBN WorldReach television program Super Kids Club. WorldReach staff put letterboxes outside of churches in the region. They encourage children to write to the Super Kids Club. When the boxes are full, pastors send those letters to the CBN office, and CBN staff members respond to those letters. A record was set for the most letters received in a single month. There are now 82 boxes set up throughout that region. Each letter is read and prayed over by the CBN staff. You can find out more about CBN WorldReach by logging on to cbn.com/worldreach.